Good afternoon, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. If we could kindly take our seats, I hope you like the new setup. Definitely an indicator of good things to come. And I really hope that you benefited from attending the different parallel sessions that were available to us before lunch and after lunch. We are now going to move into session 8. Which is really just tapping into what were the lessons learned, what were some of the insights that were shared in the different parallel sessions, because really as much as we may have wanted to attend more than one, the time was not possible. But would love to hear what was going on in the other sessions that we did not attend. So we will now be moving into that particular forum, and to facilitate that interaction and sharing will be Stephen Janus, who is the program manager for the Organizational Knowledge Sharing Program here at the World Bank. And he will be walking us through how we can share and just learn from the different experiences and insights that took place in our parallel session. So Stephen, over to you.
Thank you so much, Sweety, and welcome back, everybody. This has been a long and exciting day. And I'm glad that we still have the house full. So this is a good sign. I take this as a good sign. What we want to do in this session now is in a quite an interactive way, sort of take stock of what happened this morning and this afternoon. You've been part of a number of parallel sessions that happened this morning and this afternoon, 13 sessions in total. So there's a lot of knowledge that I'm sure has been generated and lessons learned around the how-to of knowledge capturing and sharing. And what we want to do is in this session is to think through how can we bring all that together in key messages and some takeaways that we can take home from the past 2 days, really. What we have done is in each session has nominated a rapporteur, and they will tell us a little bit what was discussed in the session and what were sort of the key takeaways for them of these discussions. And so we hope that there's going to be lots of knowledge sharing going on over the next 60 plus minutes. We're a little bit over time, so we'll see how fast we can get through the session. After we hear from the various parallel session rapporteurs, I'll be turning over the mic to Martin Rama, who's the chief economist of the South Asia region here at the World Bank, who's going to reflect a little bit on your takeaways as well and see, you know, what does this actually mean for us at the bank as well, because of course for us this is also very much a learning event and we're learning from all of you. So without further ado, what I would like to do is to start with the first session that happened this morning, session 6-1, on the question of knowledge sharing in urban environments. You know, how do cities learn from each other and to metropolitan areas? And I heard from the colleagues there were some very, very lively debates in that session. And so I'm going to ask to Phil Karp, who is our rapporteur from that session. Phil, over to you. What happened in the session? What were sort of the key takeaways from you?
Thanks, Stefan. Yeah, we had a quite interesting discussion. We had a representative from the International Cooperation Agency of the city of Medellin. We had someone from the China Center for Urban Development, from the Association of Associations of Local Government Officials from Southeast Europe, and finally from the Korea Research Institute on Human Settlements. And we first looked at the question of how knowledge sharing among cities can help with service delivery. And one of the things that was very clear in the discussion is that given the rapid pace of urbanization in today's world, cities are constantly evolving. Urbanization is taking place at a pace faster than ever in human history. So mayors, city planners, local officials, as well as citizens, are all struggling with finding solutions to address rapidly changing problems. And none of them can afford to reinvent the wheel. They all want to learn from each other. but they also face the challenge of adapting solutions from one city to another. And this points to the importance of having clear documentation of lessons, not only of what happened, but how and why, so that adaptation can happen more rapidly. Another aspect of the discussion was how to scale up. And we heard some interesting examples of how learning is being scaled up and how solutions to challenges are being scaled up from shadowing programs in the case of the network of associations of local governments in Southeast Europe, where officials shadow each other, to China's experience, as in many other aspects of adaptation and innovation in China, with piloting different approaches to addressing similar challenges in several cities, then assessing what works and finding common solutions and scaling those up. But again, this requires a rigorous assessment of how and why a particular solution worked. We also heard about the role of e-learning in scaling up and as a way of actually documenting, capturing, and creating feedback loops. And one of the interesting insights from the discussion, and I'll close with this one, was the importance of forcing a given a representative of a given institution, in this case a city, by being asked to share their experience either elsewhere within the country or regionally or globally. The effort of thinking through how, why, and what, actually, in order to really reflect on that and be able to share it, is a good way of actually capturing tacit knowledge. Because, you know, there's the old adage that one of the best ways to learn is to have to teach. So that, I think, was another insight that several of the members of the panel mentioned, that a good way of actually sharing knowledge is capturing knowledge is to have to share knowledge. And I think this is something that's applicable not only in the case of cities, but also in other forms of knowledge sharing.
Thanks so much, Phil. So lots of lessons learned on the urban side, right? And forcing to share is an interesting concept, but I think it's indeed something where we're probably kind of pushing open doors, so to speak, because many cities are increasingly harnessing their own knowledge. Very, very nice takeaways. We're moving directly into the next session, which was on knowledge sharing on education reform. And I'm asking the rapporteur of this session, I'm not sure, is Lily around or Yidan? Who is there from the education session? Not there yet, so we're waiting maybe until they join us from the education side. Moving to social development, that was the session where we're thinking about how can we connect people to solutions and knowledge sharing on social development. And I'd like to welcome Sean as a rapporteur. Sean, can you please introduce yourself, please?
Thanks. Thank you very much. My name is Sean Bradley. I work with the Social Development Group as part of the larger global practice on urban, social, rural, and resilience, if I remember correctly. We had a very, very rich discussion, and the panelists sort of spanned a variety of different contexts. We had a colleague from Togo who was looking specifically at, is involved directly in a community-driven development type social fund program. Similarly, we had a colleague from Myanmar also overseeing their national, community-driven development program, a colleague from India looking at a rural livelihoods program, and then finally a representative from GIZ who was speaking to us about a network of, I believe it was a financial Central bankers were involved. You'll have to excuse me, I'm from the social development side. Anyway, in any case, initially I thought we were going to stick right inside of a project bubble, but actually we were able to expand outside and discuss knowledge sharing and mechanisms quite broadly. So it was quite interesting. I fault the chair and moderator of our session to not being able to bring it down to three actionable points, but I'll speak with my director, Meninder Gill, later about that. And so we came away with, or at least what I wrote down in the end, was five kind of key points or takeaways from the discussion. First, I think it was to be explicit about the knowledge sharing goals of an activity within a program or outside of it. We often, as World Bank staff, and certainly a number of these panelists who were representing World Bank projects, we add capacity building becomes an add-on to a larger goal within, whether it's rural development, whether it's social development, whether it's infrastructure, what have you, and it becomes an add-on. And what the discussion really brought home was the need to make the concept of knowledge sharing, the theory of change, where are we going with this knowledge sharing, much more explicit and systematic in the actions. And also, in relation to that, think about the vertical linkages. What does the knowledge sharing and the learning at the, say, the community level have to do with higher level goals within a country, whether it's institutional or whether it's policy-based? The second takeaway was embracing of different forms of knowledge sharing and learning. There was a wide sort of consistent reference to peer-to-peer, people-to-people, village-to-village types of exchanges and the importance and the value of this kind of peer learning, which almost all the participants felt was critical and absolutely perhaps one of the most dynamic forms of learning. However, we also recognize that there's a more formal knowledge-sharing environments as well as virtual environments. So I think it's embracing the full range of the platforms and modalities to make this work. We also had from India, it was a very nice discussion about traditional knowledge sharing mechanisms such as music and festivals. So I think it's looking at the wide range of the platforms. And it's not just about brown bag lunches, as you might get the sense if you were sitting in Washington, D.C. in the World Bank. The third point was, allow for the platform to emerge organically. And I think this goes to the issue of sustainability in the long term. One of the colleague from GIZ made the reference to make the beneficiaries themselves the co-creator of the mechanism. Make this an ownership is developed and it's more likely to persist. Or as Meninder, my director, said, don't wait or depend on us, the World Bank, to put this in motion. Because if you do, you know, it may not be the right fit for you, and you could wait for a long time. Related to that is also be mindful of the transaction costs, or be mindful of the time that these platforms sometimes take. I mean, we talk about in the field of community-driven development that I work in, we spend a lot of time on capacity building at the community level with beneficiaries to undertake a number of issues, but these have high costs, and we have to be mindful that whatever we're doing and however we're delivering this knowledge sharing mechanism is worthwhile. So think about the efficiency of those mechanisms. And lastly, and I don't think this is anything novel or out of the ordinary, but it's to include a feedback loop in these processes, because otherwise it's very, very hard to tell whether or not actually the knowledge that's being shared is valuable and is being used by our beneficiaries. So that was the basis. Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much, Sean. So lots of takeaways. Please give him a hand of applause. And I think as we continue to build our library of takeaways and there's some recommendations that come out of this session, we're going to capture all of that and put it into a format that we can share with you then also as in the proceedings of this meeting. I want to move now to the topic of climate change and tackling environment and climate change through systematic knowledge sharing. And we have Emilia as our rapporteur from this session. And Emilia, if you could quickly introduce yourself and let us know your takeaways.
Thank you, and good afternoon to everybody. My name is Emilia Battaglini. For my colleagues, however, I go by Milena, and so I was introduced as Milena today. And I work in the Environment and Natural Resource Global Practice, and I was the rapporteur for this session. And this session really was focusing on knowledge management in the context of environment and natural resources and climate change. And we felt that it was particularly important to talk about how to improve knowledge sharing, because when we deal with environment, environmental sustainability and climate risk, we're really looking at a major urgent challenge that for some of our clients is actually an existential challenge. So we had a very interesting panel put together, and we approached it in around four topics. So the first topic was how knowledge in environment and climate change can influence the development agenda. And we took advantage of having the Secretary of Finance of Himachal Pradesh state in India to tell us a bit how they were so successful in advancing a green growth agenda. They really recognized the role of environment and what knowledge had to do with it. And so we got several lessons out of this, what we consider a best practice, including the ability to integrate environmental consideration and climate consideration in among the country economic drivers, and how to link natural capital to growth and resilience. We then dove into more about knowledge and knowledge tools and toolkits. And we took advantage of having the senior director of the Energy and Resource Institute in India, TERI, because their mandate is, in fact, to create and share knowledge. And it was very interesting to hear what Sangeeta had to share with us, and was successes and failure, if you want, particularly in regard to technology and the role that technology has in sharing knowledge. We talked a lot about mixing tools for sharing knowledge, webinars, Twitter chats, GDLN, the Global Distance Learning Network, but also recognizing that in some context, we still have challenges. And so in some cases, going back to face-to-face makes a lot of sense. And as somebody else said, peer learning is quite effective. As a matter of fact, we came to the same conclusion that another group mentioned, the importance of co-creating knowledge with the user of knowledge and contextualizing knowledge. We then move to a particular challenge that we have in the case of environment, and I would say also for climate change, is the case where issues are not addressed within the context of one country, but they are regional in nature. And we took the example of the Lake Victoria Basin, and how the Lake Victoria Basin Commission, that was established with a mandate to be a knowledge hub for the countries in the basin, do capture knowledge, document and disseminate it. And again, in some ways, the great results that they achieved so far, but also the challenges that are still facing. A simple thing as creating a one-stop repository of information was a challenge for the countries, but they did it, and so they got to this step. But then what remains ahead of them? Ensuring sustainable funding for knowledge, that remains a challenge. They live very much on project by project. Another challenge is translating technical information into information that is usable for policymakers on one hand and understandable to general public on the other hand. And interestingly enough, the Commission itself doesn't actually have a very robust knowledge management strategy, despite the fact that the mandate is knowledge sharing. And finally, we had a good example from a country-to-country knowledge sharing. We talked with the manager of the Green Growth Partnership from Korea. Korea, which we know is very keen in sharing their experience, has this program in place, and it's a trust fund that is managed by the World Bank. And we wanted to see how they were doing, since their focus is really on the how-to. How to avoid obstacles in achieving green growth. And the experience, again, goes back to peer-to-peer, face-to-face knowledge exchange, where practitioners can meet with other practitioners and really get just-in-time experience. So finally, sorry, I'm taking a little bit of time, but there were two topics here. Key messages. So we think that to have greater impact, knowledge management and sharing needs not only to transfer best practices, but also adapt them to local conditions. And I think we will hear this from most of other panels. We thought that knowledge is in the eye of the user, meaning it has to be targeted to the user for content, methodology, and technology. We are still struggling with fundamental challenges, and our moderator admitted that he had been working on knowledge management when he joined the bank, and he, I think, joined it, I don't know, I would say 20 years ago. So, and he said the challenges remains the same. Sustained funding, making knowledge relevant for policymakers, and delivery mechanisms that give just-in-time knowledge. So when is needed, where is needed, to those that really need it the most. So we think that we need to have a shift in the debate towards a tailored knowledge that is focused on users, is context-based, and influences the behavior of key stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Milja. So lots of takeaways from the climate change side. And I think this idea of accessibility really resonates, right? That we want to make sure that we have the knowledge in a format that we can use, and it's also there when we really need it, right? So that's really an important takeaway. I want to turn now to Roger, who is our rapporteur for the transport session, and learning a little bit about the discussions there. There was a lively interaction with our colleagues from Lamata in Nigeria. Roger, can you quickly introduce yourself and tell us what happened in the session there? What are the key takeaways?
Thank you. I am Roger Gorham. I'm with the Transport Global Practice here at the World Bank, and I also happen to be the TTL for the Lagos Urban Transport Project. And we heard from representatives from Lamata who were telling us about their experience in knowledge sharing. It was what we lacked in quantity, we made up for in quality. It was a very lively discussion among not very many people, and some of the presenters actually were not able to make it. So we really focused and drilled down in a lot of detail on the Lamata example. Lamata is the Lagos Metropolitan Area Transport Authority, who's sort of seen as a leader in Africa on pushing the envelope in urban transport, and have been working on developing their knowledge capacity. I wish I could tell you a lot about the details of that presentation, because it was fascinating. We had a video, we had a lot of sort of anecdotal stories as well as systemic stories. I don't really have time. I'll tell you the main takeaways, and one of the key takeaways that I think sort of emerged was this: the two words that are resonating in my head are organizational learning, and that is that what LaMotta really described was a process of organizational learning, of revamping the systemic culture within LaMotta to not just capture knowledge or present knowledge, but actually redefine ways that the organization itself learns from its processes. And a brief example that came out was that they've had a number of transitions recently of some senior staff who has left. And just the extent to which the confidence of the staff in LaMotta to manage that transition, including the managing director, has just left, which, you know, 2 years ago would have seemed absolutely unfathomable. But they told the story of how it was managed, and it was really quite inspirational. So organizational transition was very important. I think another theme that emerged was this notion of different kinds of knowledge that are really being mined within LaMotta. And we pointed out that there's different terms for other languages have different terms for different kinds of knowledge. They all get merged in English. We just say knowledge. In French, they say savoir, connaissance, savoir-faire. These are different kinds of knowledge. They all require different ways of capturing it and probably different ways of communicating it and having a sense of what the nature of the knowledge that you're trying to convey can really make a big difference. There was a big discussion, for example, that this concept of savoir-faire, the how-to, the know-how of getting things done, often gets sort of falls through the cracks when we try to do, you know, big knowledge capture sorts of exercises like lessons learned, and that we have to be better at doing that. Another theme that emerged, I just have these notes for myself that says Say's Law. And Say's Law is a concept in economics, and it's very big in transport, the idea that supply creates its own demand. And that the process of and somebody actually gave an example in Lagos of how the new BRT has generated a great deal of demand. But there was a lot of discussion about the idea that, well, that's really true for knowledge sharing itself, that there's, and particularly in the transport sector, we had a very small turnout, and we were saying, why is it that a lot of people aren't here? And part of it is that people just don't understand what is the real value, what's the benefit of this kind of knowledge sharing, knowledge management, organizational learning. And through the process of somehow breaking that chicken and egg cycle of actually getting it delivered, people then have an aha moment and they go, ah, I see what the real benefit and the value of it is. In some ways, I think that happens in LaMotta, because it was the bank, it was Stefan who came to LaMotta and said, look, we really need to do some knowledge organization around knowledge sharing. And there was some initial skepticism of kind of, well, okay, all right, we'll do it. But now I think they really sort of see the value of it, and it's particularly in this transition time, it's really helped them. So that's the transportation example really plays out here. There was some discussion about the idea of transport actually being a wicked problem, which is what Say's Law really says. Supply creates its own demand. Well, in transport, that's also true. You build something, and with the famous dictum, you build it, they will come. Sometimes they come, sometimes they don't come, but that's why transport is a quote-unquote wicked problem. So we had a great deal of discussion about, well, how is transport sort of reported in the media? How is it communicated to the public at large? And there was a strong sense that, you know, knowledge isn't just a sense, isn't just a question of what do we do internally, but we also need to orient knowledge sharing, knowledge understanding about the problem to the journalism community. How are they reporting on these issues? How are they understanding the issues and reporting it? Somebody gave an example of how with the new bus rapid transit extension that was built in Lagos, it actually created a great deal of demand, and they had thought they had anticipated the demand to dimension the stations big enough. And in fact, there was so much demand that some of the lines were actually on the street and overflowing the stations. And one magazine or journal, or I don't know what it was, had a headline saying BRT is a failure. And that's kind of a failure of, I mean, that headline is kind of a failure of knowledge, of a failure of the ability to communicate the complexity of some of these issues to the media. So we had some discussion about that. And also with respect to universities. So there had been some discussion about how do we integrate the universities into the knowledge, into the process of generating and capturing and communicating knowledge. And somebody actually made the observation, well, actually, there some of the universities in Lagos initially opposed what it was we were proposing to do that turned out to be a great success. So there's a lot of work to be done there. Sorry, I'm just looking at my kind of handwritten notes. I think I pretty much captured all my takeaways. Did I leave? Stefan was there, so I don't. He can tell me if I left anything out.
No, fantastic. You know, it's a very comprehensive recollection of a very exciting discussion. So thank you so much, Roger. We're moving right to the next session, which was on social protection and thinking about, you know, what is the role of knowledge sharing in social protection? We have Ruslan, who's been our rapporteur for the session. Can you please quickly present yourself and let us know what happened in the session? How did it go? And most importantly, what were the key takeaways?
Thank you very much. My name is Ruslan Yemtsov. I'm the global lead for SafetyNet. It was really an honor to be in the panel dedicated to social protection. We had really eminent speakers at this panel. They were high-level officials representing the National Coordinator for Progress, the largest conditional cash transfer program in Mexico, the director from PSNP, the largest program in Ethiopia. We had a director from Benazir Income Support Program from Pakistan, and we had a national coordinator from Luzingi program in Congo. Our discussant was a person representing International Poverty Center in Brazil, who used to be one of the directors of Bolsa Família, largest CCT program in Brazil. These flagship programs, they cover between covers between 5 and 15 million households. These are huge programs. And we were basically saying that this is really a miracle that wouldn't be possible without knowledge. 20 years ago, conditional cash transfers were just an idea. There was no country that was implementing them. And now, 20 years later, we have over 60 countries that are doing conditional cash transfers. And this country, and in many countries, these programs reached a massive scale. I mentioned already millions and millions of households that are covered by these programs. They are incredibly sophisticated, not only because they provide regular, predictable cash transfers to the poorest and vulnerable people, but also because they are all about integration of different ministries, different agencies, breaking the institutional silos, making sure things work in tandem, which never work, right? So it's kind of incredible. And what observing this evolution, and also having with us a representative from Congo, which started just from 5,000 households, a small pilot that is now being scaled up to the national level. Just seeing these programs at very different stages, we came to the conclusion that knowledge is essential at three levels or three stages of development of this program. Right? First, advocacy, proof of concept. It's really incredibly important, especially for countries like Congo who are starting the new programs, to see that things actually work, right? Advocacy. Finance ministers usually are the biggest skeptics for the cash transfers. showing them how these things works, how these things help to connect people to what already is being paid for by the state budgets. Basic services, access to productive inclusion is really impressive. So advocacy, sharing the evidence that these things work, first stage. Second stage, implementation. We often tend to think in terms of this dichotomy, success or failure, either it's a firework or things are dismal. In fact, all of this all of the life of these programs is the life of problems, resolving problems. It's a constant struggle to find the problems and resolve them. Knowledge here is absolutely essential. And knowledge is of very specific kind, because we cannot find a solution to any real life problem elsewhere. What was really amazing is that Ethiopia went to three countries, South Africa, India, Brazil, to find out how things are working for incorporating environmental rehabilitation in the public works program. And they found something closer to their concern in South Africa, but yet the solution they developed was completely different. But just the ability to observe how the same problem, similar problem is being solved in different places is essential. And we cannot predict, we cannot match, we cannot tell a priori where is the solution for this particular problem lies. Same for payment problems in Pakistan that we heard about and the solution that was developed there. And finally, the third stage is the stage of moving, transforming the program to reach yet more ambitious goals. There, we for the first time actually saw that the investment in knowledge starts paying back. This is what Brazil and Mexico are doing right now. They are actually trying to use the established knowledge infrastructure. Both Mexico and Brazil invested massively in knowledge infrastructure, in academic studies, in evaluations. They are trying to use these knowledge channels to bring back international expertise and try to see what they can learn from other countries in terms of setting more ambitious goals. So, knowledge is absolutely essential throughout the life cycle of evolution of this program. And it takes four different forms, four different avenues that all work. First is academic studies. Think about it. Mexico conditional cash transfers. There are meta studies of evaluations that are being published in research papers now. There are really hundreds of studies of this program. Why so much? Why so many? Again, I mentioned already in the first cycle, it's so important to do advocacy, to show the evidence that things actually work. So knowledge is absolutely essential. Second one is actually large forums, conferences like this one, or South-South Forum that Social Protection is organizing all the time, and where hundreds of people are coming, the practitioners are coming to learn from each other, establish the contact, to move to the next stage. The next stage is bilateral contacts. And it takes actually a lot of visits, a lot of learning from each other to use this channel. And finally, there are communities of practice. They are well alive. They were first established for the conditional cash transfers. Now they are active in many regions of the world and they connect people to each other. So these are all very alive avenue. They have to coexist to actually use the potential of knowledge in sustaining social protection programs. Please don't think that we were absolutely serious all the time. I actually learned a lot of funny things in this session. So one of those was how to address one of the biggest problems we have, how to transfer the academic knowledge into something that policymakers can use. Policymakers don't have time to follow academic research. They don't have time even to listen to summaries of the conferences and big events. So our colleagues from Brazil, who are famous for measuring everything and trying to find an optimal solution for everything, found a very interesting way. They asked the authors to write a piece that they want the policymaker to take back home to learn from. And how they found the word limit for this, 800 words was the magic number. They were trying to understand that a day of a typical policymaker and found that the only time where that person can read the brief is going to the toilet. So 800 words was the time that the average public official was spending in the toilet reading a brief on the scientific findings. That is something new I learned, and we try to use it in our practice and our knowledge work.
Thank you, Ruslan. There's always something to learn. Who would have thought on social protection? Okay, thank you so much. We're moving to education, and I would like to ask Lily what happened in the education session this morning. I heard there were very interesting and lively debates going on there as well. Can you please quickly introduce yourself and then let us know?
Do you mind if I use the podium?
Absolutely, please go ahead.
Thank you. Hi everyone. It's always hard being one of the last ones to speak in the day, so I'll try to go quickly. The members of the panel were extraordinary, both in terms of their own experiences and qualities, but also in terms of the breadth of experience that they were able to share with us. We had Serigne Baye Thiam, who is the Minister of Education of Senegal. We had Sanya Vlahovic, who may or may not be here. She is the Minister of Science for Montenegro. We had Joseph Achede, who was the National Project Coordinator for the Nigeria Partnership for Education Project. And we had Mr. Ndala, who was the Director of Education Planning from Malawi. The discussions were very far-ranging. So what I'm going to do is just take a little bit of information from each of them and give you just a bit of a taste of what was discussed rather than try to give any good summary, because it would be impossible to do so. First, we had Serigne Baye Thiam, who shared his experiences in Senegal. And the takeaway message that I have from him is how important it was when he came in to be the Minister of Education to be pragmatic and be selective, and how important it was to have the data and the knowledge at his disposal to be able to make those types of choices. He gave us several examples. I want to share with you three of them very quickly. The first one was on the issue of Quranic schools in Senegal. As some of you might know, there is a long tradition of Quranic education in the Sahel in West Africa, much of which started as a bit of a protest during the colonial period, but has since then been seen as a way of, for some very traditional societies, to not send their children to quote-unquote French schools, which are the official schools. And so he was faced with a very difficult choice of how to bring those daras, or Quranic schools, into the mainstream. And he shared with us his experiences of working with them, working around their own challenges and their own requirements in order to find a way to modernize them. And the World Bank is very proud to be a partner in this initiative that that Senegal is leading in terms of modernizing those schools. A second one was about how to allocate teachers, and the way that he uses not just the information, but his iPad. If you ever have a chance, Serigne Baye Thiam is right here, ask him the things he can check on his iPad and in order to track what is happening. And for him, the key was not just to have information, but to use information for decision making. So both in terms of deployment of teachers, in terms of tracking what is happening with the vehicles in his ministry, at any point he has GPS coordinates that allow him to see if the inspectors are in fact going to all of the schools in their catchment areas and how long they're spending in those schools. So it's not a perfect way of checking these things, but it is a way of keeping his finger on the pulse of what happens. He shared with us also the issue of fraud in teacher recruitment and how they were able to use data, including the matching of school results and exam results for teachers, evaluation results for teachers and student teachers, in order to identify that they had a very large number of student teachers who came in who were not qualified to be, and how he was able to carry the ball. And his big message, in particular with this one, was how important it is to have the political will and the courage to really move forward once the information is at your fingertips. Then we had the Minister from Montenegro, who shared with us the challenges of having a small country on the edges of the EU, ready to join the EU, and how important knowledge, curating knowledge and harnessing it for their own decision-making was. My favorite expression from what she said was about the creation of a national Facebook, a national system that they would use to have information shared. I'm sorry, I need glasses now. To share knowledge and also share information across multiple industries, across multiple agencies, and even curating information from outside the country. Montenegro is one of the countries, like mine, which has a large diaspora outside of the country, and they have found a way to harness that diaspora in order to collect the type of information and experiences they need in order to make their own national policies work better. Then we had the minister, the director of planning from Malawi, who spoke about the huge challenges they have of making sure that payments arrive to teachers. It seems like a very parochial concern. Today, with all of us having cell phones and mobile money being available in almost every type of country, poor and rich, one would think that this would be something that would be very straightforward, but he spoke a little bit about the challenges of making sure that that money gets to the teachers in time for them not to have to lose instructional time for reaching their own learning and knowledge targets. The sharing of information for Malawi was very much along the lines of this type of meeting, coming together to discuss, to take the opportunity to discuss with other partners, with other peers, to learn as much as possible something that needed to be said. Our last speaker was Director Achede, and he perhaps had the best way of describing how he feels about knowledge, which is that knowledge is life. And he gave an incredibly moving story. He shared a moving story with us about what it's like for the 10.5 million kids in Nigeria who are unable to go to school. Many of those, most of those, are girls. And the kind of challenges that they face with trying to get schools to accept children, especially girls, in very in circumstances where the infrastructure is not in place, where the resources are not in place, and where local and traditional chiefs and religious leaders may not share the same urgency that the government does with regard to getting kids in school. And he shared with us a really wonderful story about his mother and how she was able to succeed against great odds. Our discussant was Luis Benveniste, who is a sector manager at the World Bank for Knowledge and for knowledge and for knowledge sharing and innovation. And I think he said it very wisely when he said that we have this huge variety of challenges that I've just presented. There were also many strategies that were presented, including consultation with non-traditional parents like religious leaders, the issue of enhancing both leadership and teamwork, which was the point that was raised by the minister from Montenegro, creating new institutions and think tanks to make sure that we can continue to curate and adapt it. And his perhaps most telling statement was that we are always searching for adaptable and adapted contextual solutions to address challenges. In the end, what makes the difference is not only what we have as far as know-how, but in terms of, but how we use it to address the type of problems that we have. I have 4 pages of notes, but I will not continue. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Lily. I'm going to keep the cross-cutting session of the morning for the last ones. And we're moving into the afternoon, starting with the agriculture session. And there the question was, how can we actually tackle the challenges such as agricultural productivity through knowledge sharing? And I need to look into my notes. Who is the rapporteur for this session? I think we have Anjali. Yes? Great. So you're coming, now I'm getting scared, you're coming with a computer.
This okay. is 4 pages of notes, but I don't intend to reiterate.
Okay, three main takeaways.
Three main takeaways. Rather than give you all a summary of the very interesting talks we had, which I hope will be shared later, I just wanted very high level 5 main points. And just to say that our speakers were very fascinating. We had the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development from Montenegro. We had an agricultural development specialist representing Rwanda. We had the executive director of the Ministry of Agriculture and Irrigation from Peru. And we had the director of planning and policy coordination from the Ministry of Agriculture in Nigeria. And so some of the just main takeaways. that I got from this session is that the fact that this issue of learning from others, the nexus of the South-South and North-South transfer of knowledge is extremely important, can't be understated. And sort of the drivers and seeds of knowledge sharing can happen anywhere, including farmers. They can be a very great starting point for this the sort of idea of knowledge sharing, knowledge management, and the transfer of it. Also, we can't stress the overstress the importance of the role of the private sector in innovation and sort of the significance of a participatory, transparent, inclusive, community-driven process, as we saw in Rwanda and Montenegro. There's also this need to focus on the strategy and how to get the knowledge sharing process right, with a focus on the end users, and also this idea of actually getting the knowledge adopted. So governments and its partnerships with the private sector can also play a very critical role in advancing investments in agriculture, as we learned through a scheme in Peru, and sort of facilitating the trend of vertical and horizontal knowledge sharing can happen even across sectors. Government can and should also enable agencies to build on skills and human capital in rural areas. And finally, what I found very intriguing about this was, you know, agriculture is exciting in itself, especially when you're in the sector, but I think that there's the underlying importance of making it exciting for everyone and actually making it as inclusive as possible when it comes to this knowledge sharing process and never forgetting, as experts in your various fields, never forgetting the passion that you have and bringing that to the work and when you're expressing sort of the idea of knowledge management and knowledge transfer. That's
it. Excellent. Thank you so much. Okay, and we're moving into the next session, which was on scaling up solutions in health through knowledge sharing. I think there were quite some lively debates as well, Sami. Can you tell us more about what happened in the session? Three key takeaways, short, because we're running over time.
Okay, thanks, Stephen. I'll try to be as short as possible. My name is Sami Halsaharti. I work as senior health specialist in the health, nutrition, and population global practice. First, I want to acknowledge the panelists, Dr. Barry Krishnamasi and Mr. Jim Reeves from South Africa and India, and the discussant, Mr. Sergio Carmona, also from South Africa. The panel had two programs that were discussed. One is the TB mining, the TB in the mining industry in South Africa, and the other program was the HIV/AIDS in India. Both programs have, even though they were sort of different, but they have a number of similarities. One is use of evidence. Both programs heavily used different sources of data and triangulated the data to build the case, to build the knowledge base in order to be able to mobilize resources and forge partnerships. The second, when it came to implementation, because of the nature of these diseases, whether TB or HIV/AIDS, these are multi-sectoral in nature. They are caused and affect people who work in different sectors, and they have long-term implications because both, even though they are infectious diseases, but their effects happen or appear after a long time. So they have also social dimensions as well as poverty dimensions. So what both programs have done was to build partnership and forge partnerships in the case of South Africa across different sectors, having public-private partnership, as well as engaging governments in 10 countries. So this program was, or is being implemented in 10 countries in the sub-Saharan Africa. In the case of India, the program has been implemented in 32 states and union territories, involving 8 sectors and engaging about 12,000 NGOs and community-based organizations. This aspect is important because these types of complex programs, problems require the engagement of different stakeholders to co-create solutions, because solutions are not usually in just one sector or in one domain. So engaging different partners was critical. When it came to sharing knowledge, both programs have used different approaches. In the case of South Africa, they established actually a South-to-South knowledge exchange program, given the nature of implementing this program across 10 different countries. So that was done through organizational learning, developing systems for tracking, mapping and tracking existing miners as well as ex-miners, in addition to establishing innovative service delivery models. In the case of India, they were able to document and capture 24 knowledge assets related to how to implement the targeted interventions to reach out to the target population. Also, they had established a peer-to-peer learning program, in addition to establishing 6 learning sites across 2 states. I think 2 concluding remarks from this session is that going through this exercise, people did not realize how much they know until they sat down and started documenting and going through the knowledge that they had in their head. And it was very much appreciated by the staff who did that, as well as those who started using these knowledge assets. The second is that we usually know what works. The problem or the challenge is how to make it work. This is the tacit knowledge that we talk about. How to adapt a particular intervention to a different context. And the knowledge capturing tools really helped, in this case, in these 2 programs, helped them to a great deal try to capture this tacit knowledge in terms of how to contextualize the same intervention across different states in the case of India and across different countries in the case of South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Sami. So lots of interesting lessons learned in terms of, you know, how do we actually get to scale on this, right? And I think the multi-country aspect was quite fascinating as well. Moving to the next session on the knowledge sharing opportunity for trade and competitiveness. And I'm looking for a rapporteur. Yeah, there she is. Jenny, what happened in your session? Interesting. I saw some very interesting presentations.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I will keep it short. We actually had a really fantastic panel, and as you can imagine, in the space of trade and competitiveness, when you're dealing with an international organization, no organization can truly be effective in this space alone. And so we had really amazing and a distinguished panel and discussant that encompasses the private sector, the public sector, think tanks, as well as international organizations such as the World Bank. And while you had different stakeholders speaking, the one thing that we realized is whether you're talking about data or models or a huge $200 million lending project, regardless of what you're talking about, when you want to be effective and successful at knowledge sharing, you have every single speaker had the same underlying messages. And so that's really what I'll focus on, is those few, 3-ish. So the first one was, at the end of the day, you have to have senior leadership sponsorship. And so while you can have incredible programs that can be very well funded, that can be very far reaching, if the leaders in that private sector company or in your organization or in your institution do not support, truly, truly support the value of knowledge and sharing as a core component of frankly who they are, as well as representing their organization, it's hard to make that traction. And so that was the first component, is you really need senior management, not just buy-in, but the internalization of the value that knowledge plays in being successful. The second component that we realized was, while we have organizations who do lots of things, the place and the space where you're able to be most successful in knowledge sharing is when you have become a true expert in that area that is your core competency. And so whether it's that you have figured out how to develop models that can be useful to civil society organizations or that can be useful for governments when they're deciding what policies they want to focus on when they want to reform a permitting program within the government. Working with an organization that truly understands it and who knows how to do it and has a proven track record, that's a key component for success. The third component, which I think this is preaching to the choir, but in order to truly engage in successful knowledge sharing, you have to convene with your stakeholders. This is not something you can do alone. And when you're talking about stakeholders, you have to talk to stakeholders who may not be like-minded. And the public and the private sector do need to talk with one another. Civil society organizations do need to talk with one another. And so coming up and engaging in this intellectual yet practical discourse is really, really critical. The other thing that I found to be very interesting is that each of them said that awareness raising is in fact not the same thing as capacity building. And so if you're really trying to build awareness and have people understand something, that's fine. But if you're trying to enable change to take place on the ground, we have to be able to identify the difference between helping people understand a topic and being able to understand something that's very broad, but being able to customize it, adapt it, and then replicate it in the project or in the program that you're working on in your country, in your city, within your municipality, whatever it might be. And then the final component was partnerships. Again, it's a similar idea of engaging with stakeholders, but they took it to the next level. And they said, not only do we need to talk with others that are working in this space, but we also need to figure out how to partner with one another so that as a whole, we can be more successful together. So that was it.
Thank you so much, Jenny. So this aspect of leadership, right, so important, and probably one of the preconditions that was identified in that session. I want to move now to the session of disaster management, although I don't see our rapporteur right now. Pabagos, not sure if he's here. Okay, so we'll wait for him to arrive. We're moving on then to the session on decentralization, and I think there we had quite a lively debate as well on how does knowledge sharing support decentralization efforts, and we had different examples and devolution in that session. And I would like to ask Murata as the rapporteur to come here. Yeah. Perfect. Thank you, Murata. If you can quickly present yourself and what are sort of the key takeaways that the team has come up with there.
Sure. All right. So I think the first thing in terms of knowledge is that Stefan needs to learn how to pronounce my name. Murata.
Oh, Murata.
But Murata is also fine. It means friend in my language. So just as well. We had a very good panel bringing together Indonesia, which has had decentralization for a while, Kenya and Tunisia, which are sort of in transition, and then Colombia, where they were sharing an example, which was in a more limited area on issues around natural resource management, and which are quite important for revenues for local governments. I think one of the things we all accepted is that very diverse context, and that realization that even as we talk about knowledge sharing, we need to understand that it's context specific, but that said, that there's still a lot of lessons that different countries can learn from each other. And in fact, at some point, the governor from Kisumu, who was one of the speakers from Kenya, said, wow, did we get our constitution from Indonesia? It sounds very much the same. And I think actually, in a lot of ways, decentralization design does borrow from other countries. I think going back to the basics, one thing that really came out is that decentralization is very much about citizen engagement, citizen participation, and that came out as a huge source of knowledge, involving citizens in originating solutions and tapping into that local knowledge. And also within that, what the feeling was also tapping into universities, which I think doesn't always happen with local governments, and also, but also tapping into professional associations, which in a country like Kenya are starting to emerge in some of the county governments. The other thing that came out was relationships between national government and county or local governments, as may be the case in other places, where the relationships sometimes are tense, especially where you're still transitioning. And in any case, even in mature, decentralized countries like the US, you still have problems between federal and state. But getting the right level of relations so that each can learn from the other was felt to be quite important. Moving on, I think the other key thing that came out was, again, the need to invest time and resources to understand the local context. So for instance, in the case of Colombia, where they said, you know, you're working with very many different and diverse local governments, and before proposing solutions, you need to be able to understand what their context is. Something that came out and I think has been mentioned by one of the other groups is investing in knowledge hubs and also investing in information management. So, you know, if you take the case of, for instance, Indonesia, where I think there were, is it 533 or something districts, that's a lot of information. And being able to process that and share it is something. And I think Kenya is also having a center for devolution studies. So there was a number of examples given in the group. I think something that came out was this challenge of moving from information to knowledge. So I don't know if that's also related to the point that came out right now about awareness. So I think in many of these places, people go and see things that are working, but being able to understand why they are working, I think that doesn't always happen when you're doing knowledge sharing. And so you may see something, try to replicate it, but don't get the same results because you did not understand what was it that actually led to that change. I think also linked to that was a lot of, and I think this example came from Kenya, but might also be relevant elsewhere. People love study tours and benchmarking and going and elsewhere, but many of these are not systematically documented, and even less so are not shared. So you may have two or three people who go at great expense to a foreign country and see what's happening. But I think more needs to be done to ensure that that's properly documented and also shared when people go back. And I think one tension we have in Kenya is what balance between taking people away or bringing one or two people who can interact with, say, 100 or 200 people. I think in terms of the role of the World Bank in all of this, I think a lot of knowledge around decentralization. And I think examples were given, our facilitator is a decentralization lead within the bank, but you know, at least two, three countries, all of whom want support, say on things like conditional grants, which I think, for instance, Indonesia spoke about within the session. So the bank was seen as a partner that has got cross-country knowledge. I think one point I'd say personally, also working at the bank, is in as much as we have all this knowledge, maybe we need something around a pedagogy of how countries, institutions learn. When I look at the case of Kenya, I think right from the onset, I had colleagues who knew what problems we were going to have 2-3 years down the road. But at that time, trying to engage with counterparts when they had not even started doing that process, they were not able to learn at that point. And I think right now, at least 3 years down the road, we're having a very lively discussion on conditional grants, which if you mentioned that 3 years ago. So sometimes even if you know the problems that countries will have, it's worth giving them time to sort of go through it. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Murata. So the question of timing in knowledge, very, very interesting. Very good. We'll move to sort of the cross-cutting sessions. And we had a session in the morning dealing with the question of how can we actually develop effective and sustainable service delivery? And what does it take to get to a service delivery that is resilient against people moving in and out of the organization and tacit knowledge, therefore also leaving the organization. I would like to ask Melody to come and share with us what were sort of the key takeaways from that session, Melody.
Thank you, Stephen. Actually, for this morning session towards this topic, towards effective and sustainable service delivery, I think it's a very hot topic because not only five resource persons from Germany, Colombia, and Moldova, and so on. Our room is full of participants. So since Stephen said we just share three takeaways. First, I want to say is diversify the challenge. For example, some say we like good quality tools, we like good product, we like good service, and we all have very similar challenging and issue like key person risk, like staff turnover, and we need practical solution, how to capture useful knowledge, where is the right tools, and how to evaluate. So many challenges. So that's the first point. The second is, it's so diversified challenges that trigger knowledge sharing needs. And from strategic level and operational level, so let's come to the third point, that how can we overcome the different challenges during our service delivery? That's all related to the eight pillars of knowledge sharing framework, I think so. For example, we need open culture, we need open platform, we need have a very systematic capturing instruments, methodology, and tools. So, and we also need a very systematic evaluation procedure. So finally, we want to say we need to keep innovative way, we need continued resilience to make sure we have a very effective and sustainable service delivery. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Melody. And the last session, Camilo, you're going to tell us a little bit of what happened in the session on scale-up and in how knowledge can be used to scale-up and what are the scale-up strategies. And you had a very full house in that session.
I'm Camilo. I work with the Knowledge Sharing Program based in Colombia as a local consultant. We have a very lively session with a very rich conversation at the end, especially. If we had to give a headline for the lessons that we got from our conversation, I would say learning and knowledge sharing are two faces of the same coin. Because if we could create a tech cloud of all the presentations, learning came again and again and again from different perspectives. But then, which were the experiences? We have different approaches to scaling up. We had a national from Kenya. We heard how to scale up, going down into the different levels, involving to the even the local actors, local level governments, the school of government in Kenya. So scaling up is about going down, reaching all the layers in the public administration. But they don't know exactly what they have to do there because they have a new constitution, so it's learning at the same time as they do research and find out what they have to share with the different authorities. We had an experience from Chile, Council on Innovation. Here, scaling is not about layers going through different levels in the administration, but they know how to convene different actors from entrepreneurs, academia, NGOs, governments, and so on. They know how to do that. And in that case, scaling up is about applying this same method to different challenges, different problems that the country is facing, from disasters to logistics in ports and so on. So the challenge for them on scaling is how to do the same in different domains. Another approach was more oriented, centered on education. From Monterrey, from Mexico, they know how to do it. They know how to offer courses online. This is the online area on the Monterrey school. They know how to do that, and they apply it into different topics, different domains, but also they grow geographically. They also scale up by reaching people through all Latin America. It's a Spanish-speaking community. A similar case was from Slovenia. They are working specifically in a specific sector on finances and working mainly with civil servants, and they scale up by going to different countries. They involve different actors in the region around Slovenia. So when we talk about the scaling up, it depends on where do you stand. We are talking about different things. But learning was the key common keyword. So some key thoughts on learning. And I'll start with the last a quote that Karina shared with us at the end, at the very end, a quote from Alvin Toffler that says, "The literate from the 21st century will not be the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn." So it's about how we handle learning. And on learning, then we have issues. So we had contributions around something that was already mentioned here. It is not about what to do, but how to do it. And then the context becomes very important. It's not something that I can tell you how to do it and you will copy it. You need to tune it. It's a situated learning process. Then we are talking about practices, how things are done, how people relate, how information is exchanged, what kind of products you put in a website. If we want to scale up, then we need to make sure that we are copying and expanding works. Because we don't, if it's a failure at local level and we scale up, then we can create a real problem. So we need to make sure that what we are scaling up is something that works. And the suggestion here is you must learn as you go ahead with your project. It's not something that you do at the end as a result of an evaluation. Evaluation might be very expensive and might come too late. So learning is something that should take place along the way. All the time you should learn on the process to find out what is working, but also what is not working. We need to learn from mistakes. We need to learn from failures. And that implies to create space to have conversations around failures, not only about the success stories. So that was it. I don't know if my colleagues want to add something.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Camilo. And last but not least, our session on disaster management. Professor Mohsen Ashtiani has kindly agreed to share with us two, three key takeaways from that session. What has happened, Professor?
Thank you so much. I'm not the reporter of the session, but I have been asked to give this short report since he was not here. We have discussed the key role in the disaster risk management. In disaster risk management, we know that we live in a very vulnerable environment, high risk of natural disasters. And we know we have enough knowledge, we have enough regulations, enough policies. The key challenge is implementation of what we know, putting ground our knowledge in the ground. And the gap between the knowledge and implementation, it can be reduced by knowledge sharing. Knowledge sharing is a key to implementation of our existing know-how in order to reach a sizable environmentally safe and safe cities and good livelihood. Experience of Indonesia, Iran, and Chile as a three countries that were successful in having the implementation of risk reduction measurement in the past years have been explained. For example, in Indonesia, after the tsunami, they had, in past 10 years, they had extensive amount of work. They are working toward the risk reduction, and knowledge sharing was a big component. In Iran, for example, after earthquake 1990, a lot of effort has been done toward risk reduction, and we made a great achievement in Iran. And again, knowledge sharing and public awareness, culture safety, again, was a key issue. And in Chile as well, the great experience they have with the earthquake and tsunamis. The question was asked, what is the knowledge? What do we want to share? We want to share the knowledge that people need. We need to share the knowledge that people need. We're not sharing the knowledge of scientific, you know, papers. Though we have to address the people's demand, knowledge sharing creates a culture. It connects to the people. It connects the scientists, policymakers, engineers, and public. We have to make, through the knowledge sharing, make seismic safety, earthquake safety, or natural hazard safety a demand in the society. When people ask for it, the policymaker would do it. Therefore, knowledge sharing is a key in implementation of risk management, and knowledge sharing is an effective way to put what we know on the ground. And this all can be done not with a unique approach. Each approach for knowledge sharing in different countries, it has to be, it has its own prescriptions. It might be all the same, but it has to be locally adopted. It should be culturally adopted. It should link the people, and knowledge sharing links not only the scientists, but links cultures, links communities, links cities, links nations. We are here for that purpose. And there is a lot of good lessons that we have to learn. A lot of documents exist that we can use to learn. And we can learn from the bad examples in order to avoid it. So we have to look at the good lesson learned, and we also have to look at the bad experience to not repeat it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Mohsen. So that is the summary of 13 sessions. Wow, it's hard to summarize all of this. But I mean, I think there's a few key takeaways that we can learn from this. And before I'm trying to summarize, and I have actually somebody here who can reflect a little bit on this, and Martin Rama, chief economist at the World Bank for the South Asia region, is going to give us a little bit of an impression of, you know, what are you taking away from all of this? A lot of stuff.
A lot indeed. Thank you very much, Stefan, and good afternoon again to all of you. So my name is Martin Rama, I'm the chief economist for South Asia. The World Bank regroups countries in these regions. We have six of them. So South Asia is everything from Afghanistan to Bangladesh, from Nepal to Sri Lanka. That's the area where I work. But I'm very pleased to see this really global group and to meet friends from different incarnations in my career and different parts of the world here. I'm very pleased about that. But as you say, Stephanie, it will be very challenging to try to summarize what was discussed. I was listening really with enormous interest and actually learning, since we are talking about learning from your experience in these 2 days. But let me try not to summarize, but to give a few points, thinking especially in which ways we can help. As I was listening to the different rapporteurs, I was thinking, okay, so how can we help with the different things that are being presented? And when I say we, is the entire institution, the entire World Bank. And let me make it clear, by help I do not mean necessarily financially. One thing I really like is this is about knowledge sharing. This is about ideas. And one can argue that development happens through ideas. Finance is a means towards the implementation of these ideas, but there is the ideas that really change the world. So what do I take from the different sessions, from the different conversations? I would like to regroup my takeaways under the form of four words and elaborate a bit on each of them. And the first is obviously learning. As I said before, development happens through ideas, but the big question is which ideas to pick up. We are in a world where we are constantly bombarded with different thoughts, different innovations. There are thousands of academic articles published every day, and they far exceed the 800 word limit that Ruslan taught us was so important for readership. There are millions of news articles that are published. There are thousands of websites being put online every hour. And so we are looking for ideas. We don't want to reinvent the wheel. But where do we go for those ideas? You are the champions of change in your own countries. You know the problem you are facing. You want to seek solutions. And so how can we help with that? And there, one thing we obviously do, and I would say it's an entry point, but it's like the low-hanging fruit, we tend to digest. One thing we do a lot at the World Bank is to digest knowledge experiences in ways that can be communicated. In general, what happens is that many of the innovators tend to be doers. They are not writing about what they do. And so part of our job is to try to synthesize that. And even if they were to write, that's not their comparative advantage. Their comparative advantage is to get things done. It's like when you see a painting, painters sometimes write books. I have never found the books by painters very interesting. These are paintings that are interesting. So part of what we do is to try to digest that. I personally had the honor of serving as the director of one of our World Development Reports. World Development Reports are a way to take one subject, conflict, gender, jobs, risk, the internet, and then say, okay, what do we know? What are the good experiences about it? But I would say, that's just a first step. It's an important step, but it's a first step. Why is only a first step? It's because a lot of the learning doesn't happen through the hard evidence. Yesterday, in fact, we had another conference in another building, and it was about data. And a former chief economist of the World Bank, who also happens to be a very accomplished economist, was given the initial lecture, and he was telling us, you know, we all learned a theory of knowledge in high school and in other places where evidence was really the trigger of the change in paradigms, in the change of in thinking. And he said, forget about that. That's wrong. It's in many cases, it was not by very serious measurement that big changes happened. It was by seeing. It was through the telescope and seeing the moons around Saturn that people thought, no, it cannot be. It's not the sun going around the Earth. It has to be the other way around. And he had many examples of that sort. So the point I want to make here is that the seeing is believing, is the reason why things like our publications maybe help, but may not be the whole thing. Just going and visiting the experience of other countries which have done it, successfully, which have done it in different ways, is extremely important. Of course, one can help partially, and again, I will not want to downplay, with electronic ways of doing this. We can do a lot of e-learning, distance learning, video conferencing, and that helps. But my sense is that, again, that helps with the nuts and bolts. It does not give you the aha moment. You don't get that realization that here is something that is fundamental for what I'm trying to do. That you get through really talking to the people who did it, seeing what they did. And so I would say while the distance learning, the video conferencing and all that, we're very happy to put it at your service, we also need to go beyond that. In another seminar that was happening yesterday, Dr. Boldy, who is here who led a very innovative program in the state of Himachal Pradesh in India. One of the questions I asked to Dr. Baldi was, not everybody in India is doing things as you did. What are the ways to convey that experience to others? And I will interpret the answer that Dr. Baldi gave me as saying, well, we don't have a platform for that. He said, the secretaries of water get together, the secretaries of agriculture get together. We don't have a mechanism for the secretaries of finance to get together, except to discuss how much money I'm getting from the center, not so much about what is the experience. So platforms, I would say, in addition to publications, in addition to digital vehicles, e-conferencing, distance learning, platforms are very important. And again, one thing we can offer as support is South-South Learning Exchange. I'm sure many of you have been involved in going to one place and learning from that place, or receiving visitors and sharing your own experience. So that's on the first word, the learning. Publications, video conferencing, and facilities of that sort, platforms for exchanging. The second word I took away from the conversations today is adapting, or in the words of the disaster session, implementing. Like, learning alone will not do. It's not like, oh, I found a solution and now I will do exactly the same at home. And there, again, I thought there were several important ideas that came up in listening to the rapporteurs. One is countries are not alike. Conditions are different. So the environment in which you will be operating are different. My cities are more spread out than your cities. People in my country work more in agriculture than in yours, and things like that. Ruslan, in telling us back from the session on social protection, referred to the importance of academics and local experts to really help tailor things. And we are strong believers that think tanks, local think tanks, local expertise are crucial to do that. So what can we offer on that? Typically, the kind of things we can do is to help with workshops, with conferences that can help bring together the experiences from abroad to your places, to bring your own experts and to learn together how to move on that. There is also difference across countries in the institutional organization. It's not just how the country works, but how government works and how you can make things work. And there I found very interesting the point that Morata, am I pronouncing well? That Morata made on decentralization, on the way governments work differently. So what can we offer to help with that? That's so specific, it's so country specific. My impression is that that's where the finance comes in, that projects, that development policy lending, you can see them as a vehicle for finance, but they're basically a vehicle for coordination, to get the actions together, to get the different entities in government together, to get the attention of senior leadership to say, yes, we need to do that, and I will push for that, and I will make it happen. So I would say projects is projects and development policy lending are among the things we can do. There were also comments on potential resistance. There was the example of Lagos mass transport and people overflowing and the media saying, there you go, it's a failure. Look at it, people are on the street. So there is an important element of communication also that is, again, very country specific. And we do have, again, to help elements of outreach. We have our external affairs people who are constantly in the social media with the journalists, and that's, again, a resource. So again, my second word was adapting or implementing, and things like conferences, projects, and outreach are issues on which we can help. Third word, and it's a bit of a, I'm cheating a bit because it's two words, it's scaling up, but I will put it as my third word, is that typically when we go through the adaptation, through the implementation, even if a project can be hundreds of millions of dollars is often small in the scale of a country. And one of the questions is how you go from there, from your success, from your first 5,000 people in your conditional cash transfer program in Congo to a national program in Congo. And then again, I heard important ideas, I believe. The idea of piloting, the proof of concept, which I think projects actually do that. A project where it's not like you are discussing how buses will run, but in the end you see the buses running, has a part of that demonstration effect. You do it in a city, other cities say, oh, I will try that. I will be tempted to try that. But there is more than that. I think there is a need, and I strongly believe in this one, there is a need for good data. For anything that is telling the story, is not just hype, is not just spin. Sooner or later, you have to anchor it in data. One of the things in which I strongly believe in which we can help is strengthening national statistical systems, strengthening the production and access to credible data that people can trust. They can think, oh, this is not just something that is being cooked up. This is the best we can tell. Of course, there are always mistakes, but they are honest mistakes. These are the best information we can have. So that's one area in which we are doing quite a lot, and I hope that we now, with the sustainable development goals, we will be doing much more, but I see it as a very important element to the scaling up. And then one other thing that was mentioned is rigorous impact evaluation. At some points, it's seen as believing. At some points, you really need the proof of evidence, and we have, in some cases, with the help of development partners, relatively large programs to try to build impact evaluation, rigorous impact evaluation in what we do together with you, so that we can learn and we can say this worked or this didn't work. And so that we know, as was said in the last session by, I believe, our Iranian colleague, learning from the good examples and learning from the bad examples. So the projects, data, impact implementation. And that was my third word that was scaling up. But I want to finish very briefly with a fourth word, which I take away, and in fact, I strongly believe in it, but I was pleased to see it, which is owning. And here you have country-led. I started with knowledge sharing, but country-led is as important as that. None of these can happen with us just simply trying to push things through you. You are the champions. These tools I was referring to are the things, the ways in which we can help you. But as was said in the transport session, without the senior leadership, without the leadership at your level, the ministers, the directors, the secretaries, none of this will happen. So put yourself in the driver's seat, and as you see, we see our role as helping you going through all this. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Martin, for the very eloquent reflections on this very, very diverse set of takeaways that came from and transpired from the various sessions. I think we've come to the end of the session. I apologize, we went a little over, I'm just going to say two things that I'm taking away from it, and one thing that I actually haven't really heard so much is the learning from mistakes. I just want to say Morada, I learned from my mistake. So I'll remember that one. The other thing is I want to thank all of you because you have helped me to deliver on the homework that ABBA has given me yesterday on the various things that still we want to cover today, right? And some of the questions around the enabling environment, some of the tools, the approaches that institutions are taking to actually getting ready for knowledge capturing, sharing. I think lots of these solutions have come out of the many sessions. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for sticking into and hanging in into this late afternoon. And I think we're ready to move to the closing session. But before I do that, give yourself a big hand of applause.